Mm-hmm. So if this guy was only paying interest alone, in 20 years, all his payback is 5,000. But because he's paying by compound interest, in 20 years, he will have paid 38,400 euros. So when you borrow money, the longer you borrow the money, and that's why the bank has devised a very well strategy called minimum payment. Some banks are good. They will tell you in your statement that if you make the minimum payment, they will tell you how long it will take you. But some don't. And if you're not careful, if you are paying the minimum, if you are paying, what happens is that if you pay the minimum, you are only paying the interest. So the capital is not being paid. And that will drag on for a very long time. And the bank will make a whole lot of money. So I just want to expand on this so that we understand how debt and interest works. Now, let's start this. To the most important part, how do we get out? Well, I'm told you are in this situation. Already living beyond your means. The first step is to know what your means are. If you want to get out of something, you have to know what your means are in the first place. So if you're living beyond your means and you want to get out, the first step is to know what your means are. Now for people who are being paid, it's a bit easier to know how much that's coming to you, to your pocket. It's not just enough to know how much you earn in figures, but how much of it actually gets to you. Now, people who are doing business, it might be, or who don't have consistent or regular income, it could be a bit more difficult. But you have to find a way to find an average, just to have as accurate as possible your needs. And then you need to have a budget. A budget is just an organized form of your outgoings and your income. In other words, your income and your expenses. And this has to be written down. This has to be written down. As a matter of fact, even if you are not spending beyond your needs, it's a good strategy for everybody to keep hold of your spending. I cannot overemphasize it. I learned this a long time ago and has worked wonders in my life. I can go back 3 years and check how much I spent in a particular month. In 10 years, I can go back. My wife used to be following me. Now, and life is so easy these days because we have different tools that can help us. Those of us who are good, I'm an old style person, so I have to write things down. But you need to find what works for you. But if the digital works for you, there are different free applications that we can use on our phone that will help us keep tabs on our spending, our income, so that and then you'll be able to see at the end of the month, where is the money going? Some people just complain, I don't know why this money is just going. I know it's just going. But if you keep tab on them, if you have a budget, you can look back. So in this one, and a good part is also to divide it into categories. Like probably if you have a mortgage, things after the mortgage, like insurance of the house, you know, and then for the cars, like the insurance of the car, the tax of the car, you know, and then for the groceries. You know, you can divide it into stages, into categories. And then you can try to find out. So the major part of my income was actually being spent on food or on clothing or you know, and this will help you because if you have something to go back onto, you need it because you have to go back here. So in this area now, this is where I'm spending most of the money. Either to reduce this a little and to reduce this a little. You can work it around to arrive at something that will help you. So and then your budget, that's realistic. Your budgeting has to be realistic. I was at a seminar a long time ago in Denmark where Pastor Daniel, I think now, I was talking about something similar, setting goals. And then it was encouraged that while setting your goals, you must be realistic. Don't set an unrealistic goal. Yes, you want to set a high goal for yourself, but don't set something that's unrealistic. If you are somebody who earns 1,000 and the 1,000, maybe your salary is paid on the 25th, and by the 5th of the next month, your salary is zero. And then you want to set the goal to save. And then you tell me, this from the end of this month, I'm going to start saving 50% of salary. That's not realistic. So in your budgeting, you have to be realistic. You have to keep your finances in order. Like I said, you have to record all your source of income. Know if you're getting salary, if you're getting money from social services, if you're getting child benefit, child care, you know, all the money you get, put them together, put them as an income. And they also get a list of your expenses, the bills, everything, get them together, and then you do the maths. This does not require advanced skill. So, I want to do the maths now. The result will determine where you are. If the income, if the expenses outweighs the income, there's problem. Hallelujah. But if after doing the math, and then the income, the expenses is less than the income, that's good news. That's what we should be. And we can start from that. But if, as I said, if the income is more than the expenses are more than the income, then you need to make an adjustment. And let's go to the next. And I put that adjustment in red because that's important. If you don't make an adjustment, you have to go into debt to borrow. Next slide, please. So, the adjustment required is to change your spending habits because that is what got you there in the first place. So, if you are here today and you go home and you do your math, and you find out that your expenses are more than the income, you need to make adjustments on your spending habits. Something is not right. It's not because you're not earning enough money. It's because something is not right. If you earn more money tomorrow, it will still be the same story. So, you need to spend wisely. And the very simple style to spend wisely is to ask yourself these three questions. If you can do this from now henceforth, you'll find out that you spend wisely and you save more money. And the first thing is, when you get to buy something, ask yourself, do I need it? You want something different from you need it. Like I said, you only have 20 pairs of shoes at home. You find a beautiful one in the shop, you didn't even plan to buy it, you just walked by and you saw the 50% discount. And you thought, oh, this should be nice. So before you go in and drop your money, ask yourself, do I need it? If you don't need it and you buy it, it's a waste of money. Whatever you don't need and you buy, it's a waste of money. Now the next thing you want to ask yourself, so if you actually find that you need it, maybe you have only one shoe, and that shoe that you have already getting old, it's getting torn, so you need a new shoe. The next thing to ask yourself is, okay, can I afford it? Can I afford it? So like I said earlier, for that month, you know that for that month you have just 100 euro extra. And the shoes cost me 350 euros. Can you afford it? No, you can't. If you cannot afford it and you buy it, you're going to go with it. So let's assume, okay, the shoe cost 100 euro actually, and you have 100 euro extra in your hand. Then the next question is, can I get it cheaper somewhere else? These are three rules you must apply going forward for me. I bought a TV recently for my children. I was walking by in the shop and I saw the TV. I asked, wow, this is a good price. Because I bought a similar one previously, I know the price. So when I saw the price of this one compared to that, I said, wow, are the price for this so fast? But I did buy it. So I come home. I decided to repair the wardrobe. But I couldn't get the repair to repair one day. The guy that was repairing TV, I went to his place, moved the wood somewhere else. I was calling him before I couldn't get it. So, but to cut the long story short, I found out, okay, if I could repair it, this is a 5-year-old TV. If I repair it, what if I repair it for 100 euros, for example, and the next day it got broken again? So I might be better than actually buying the new one. So I tried to check on the internet to compare prices. And indeed, that shop has the lowest, really. But there's one other shop that has the same price as this shop. So these two shops has the lowest in all the shops in online. But these two shops now, I wanted to buy the insurance and the TV from them. Now this shop that has the lowest price has a maximum of 3 years insurance. While the other shop has a maximum of 5 years. Now, the price of insurance for 5 years is the same for the price of insurance for 2 years. So, by going home to compare online, I saved myself 300 euros. Yes, indeed, it was cheaper, but if I bought that shop, I would have paid in that shop, I would pay for the insurance as well. But now I got an insurance for 5 years now for the price I got it for 2 years. So, in other words, what am I saying? Even right there in the shop, on your phone, you can do a quick search. I do that a lot of times. When I saw something I like in the shop there, because I always want to make sure that I pay the best price for something. I just go home happy, thinking that I made a good deal. So, before you pay for anything, and this applies to children as well, I teach my children a lot. We go, when we go out to swimming or to the gymnastic classes, they have these shops there. And they always want to buy, I said to them, listen to me. This one you're buying for 2 euros, if you get the deals, we're going to buy it for 1 euro. So do you want to buy one thing or you want to buy two things? Of course, they will choose two things. So it's a skill that we should also teach our children as they are growing up. So, because if you can buy it cheaper somewhere else, why are you wasting money? Why? You have worked hard for your money. If you save that money can go into your emergency fund. It can go into your children's savings fund. It can go to charity. It can go to different things. As the thing is that sometimes we think it's little. But when you add all this little money together, and when you put it yearly, it will shock you how much you are going to save. So, very important from now henceforth, try to apply these three rules. Ask yourself first, do you need it? If actually you need it, can you afford it? If you actually afford it, can you get it cheaper somewhere else? If you don't, then buy it. If you can, go somewhere else. Now, you also need to review your budget. The budget you are doing to review monthly, at least. As I said, you need to set realistic goals. Don't say you want to be saving too much money. No, say what you think you want for your child. And then try to get out of debt. Now, to get out of debt, you have to go along with it. It will be a temporary measure, but you have to do it. So you can take an extra job, you can work extra hours. It's not going to be a long time. Don't do it for a long time. But focus on the short-term goal to pay back your debt. And most importantly, you have to be disciplined. If you're not disciplined all this, you'll do for 1 month and then you just forget about it. Next step is, I'm glad our children are in a very important part for both the adults and the children. Next slide, please. Next slide. Thank you. Yes. Service. Now, I cannot overemphasize this. Like I said earlier on, what age, how early should you start to save? And I want to say that you should start saving as early as possible. As a matter of fact, when the child is born. When the child is born, start to save. Open a bank account for the children. How many children are saving here? Good. So it's good our children are saving. They are good examples for us. So as parents, and those are the children saving, they are saving with piggy banks, which is good for them to have a fiscal experience. But it's even important for us to open a bank account for every child. They don't need to be of age. All they need to open a bank account is to have a DPS number. So if you have four children, open four separate bank accounts for them. Now you don't have to put 500 euros. If you can afford 500 euros, why not? But even if it's just 100 euros, even if it's just 50 euros, you spread it for each of these accounts. I don't have time, I'll show us some the next exercise. I will show you, if you put 100 euros into an account, how much it will be. Especially in the high yielding account, if you put 100 euros for 18 years, how much it will be to show. So let's open, if any of our children does not have a bank account, please let's open one for them and let's put money in there regularly. So it's very important for us as well for the children. Now, when you save for these children, the thing is that as they grow up, for example, and they become older, and you hand over their accounts to them, you begin to understand the importance and the habits of saving. And eventually, you're going to hand over a good amount of money for them. And not only that, but most importantly, you would have hand over to them a habit that will be of benefit to them. So that's very important. So like I said, our savings is important because it's good for emergency fund. And we must also have short and long-term financial goals. What are short-term financial goals? Savings will help to achieve your financial goal, whether it's short term, whether it's long term. As I said earlier, you first get the habit of having at least 3 to 6 months to do of your monthly expense saved. Now your long term to be to retire, it will be your retirement. Now some of us we are working hard now. What we imagine where we don't work hard anymore. Are we making plans for our retirement? Or are we just leaving it to a chance? Want to give yourself to the government, the social? You need to see people who are living on the government. I used to tell my wife, a lot of people, they work hard, they live really good life when they are young or adult. But because they do not make sufficient plan for their retirement, in their retirement days, they are going to leave their home. And what will leave with their children? And the children will grow up these days. So you must make plans for your own future. It's a long term goal, but you can start from now. Hallelujah. Is it your long term goal to buy your own house? If you have a good savings, it will help towards your deposit. And the bank also look at you as somebody who is credible. Next slide, please. And the question some of us want to ask is that I'm already operating on a tight budget. How can I save? Even the money I'm earning now is not enough. How can I save? Now, how quickly here, the first step, like I said earlier on, it's not about how much money you earn, okay? Just about your spending habits. And I'm reading here quickly here, the first step to being able to save is to save first. Now, the nature of people is that people spend first and then they try to save later. Let's spend now. So the leftover, we're going to save. But it doesn't always work out that way. So the first step is to save first and spend the rest. So if you plan to save 100 euros every month, for example, when your salary comes in, that 100 euros goes into your savings first. And then you manage the rest. Now, life is so easy now because you can automate this. The direct debit is there. So if you get your salary on the 25th, for example, put the direct debit on the 26th before you go deep into the salary. So by the 26th, the money is gone. You don't worry about it. Because within yourself, you can forget or not remember. And also, that will help you to avoid unnecessary issues coming up. Because issues will always come up. We asked our friends came home watch us recently and they were talking about their desire to buy their home house. And I was encouraging the young man that one of the most important things you have to do is to get into the habit of saving. Because the first thing the bank will ask you is your savings account. If you had €1 million in a month and you're not saving in time, the bank is not interested in you. Because if you had 100 million and you spent 100 million, then what's the assurance that they give you an extra 500,000, you're going to be able to pay back? Because when you spend far more than that, who is saving regularly outside his other expenses has a lot of credibility with the bank. So I said to the young man, that's what you have to do. It's going to help you to get, because if you save for 1 year, for example, at the end of that 1 year, you have to put that amount of money you can put up for your deposit. And it also helps with the bank as well. And then the work measures that, yeah, we try to do that, that it doesn't work out. It's, you know, that is like, okay, what you have to do, it will never work out if you did manually. People always come with needs that you cannot ignore. But if somebody comes before the money grows, then you can plan it for the next month, or that month. But if that already gone, okay, you can plan it for the following month and see if you can fit it to your budget. But this money is going in and it's really a card for you. So that's what you have to do. Save first, automate it, and then look at where you can cut your cost. Look at where you can cut your cost. There are different areas where you can cut your cost. Cut your cost here, cut your cost here, cut your cost here, 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 here. I tell the money to find out the little you have cut in every, you can put that in the savings. Example, if the utility bills at home, if you're paying 100 euros for your cable TV, for example, you can look for a cheaper one. I mean, your phone bills, for example. I mean, I used to pay 45 euros for my phone, for example, and I got an offer for 10 euros, getting the same thing I'm getting. So, in other words, on my phone bill, on my mobile bill, I'm saving 35 euros. In 10 months, that's 250 euros I've saved. In less than 1 year, I've saved 250 euros just on my phone bills. Because I switched from contracts to what you call SIM card, or whatever it's called, SIM only or whatever. It's still the same phone. I made my cut, and I'm saving over almost 400 euros a year. Now, by the time I look into my electricity bill, by the time I look into my insurance, by the time I look into other areas, I'll be able to report a reasonable amount of money that will go into savings. So you have no excuse that you cannot save. You see some salary, but because I'm able to cut, I'm looking inward to areas where I cut my cost, my cost. And finally, not finally, but almost finally, let your money work for you. I don't want to advertise any bank here, but you can go do your research. I made a mistake myself in the past, I'm learning from it now. Don't just put your money in any bank. No. There are banks that can offer you as much as 3.5% interest. If you put your money in that bank, those kind of banks, for a long time, you're going to get something reasonable. So do your investigations, look for high yield interest accounts, look for that, and put your money there. And now finally, I know we have talked about debt. I thought we are scared of debt now. But not much of us know that not all debt are bad. They are actually what we call good debt. They are actually good debt. So when a debt is used to acquire an asset or an investment, it is termed as good debt. Are you doing? So if you borrow money to buy a house, for example, an asset, something of good value, that will likely increase in value. So if you borrow money to do that, that's not good value, that's a good debt. So if you borrow money to buy a house, for example, that's a good debt. If you borrow money, if you cannot afford your study and you borrow money to study, that's also a good debt. Now, one thing with good debt to find out is that their interest rate is very, very good. So if you borrow money to study, for example, and you never pay the money back after you finish your exam, and you got a job at a particular salary, the bad debt are the opposite. They are high in interest rates, and they are used for things like console, things like that doesn't have any value, the most time they have ability of yours. Now, why is it important for us to differentiate between good debt and bad debt? Because by adventure you have both, and you're planning to pay them off. So that your focus will be on paying off the bad debt first, because they have no value. A quick example, the mortgage on your house, for example, if you have a good lender, for example, you can get a mortgage that's low as probably 2-3%. And the interest on the credit card, for example, like 18.5%. That's more than 5 times. Thank you. Next slide, please. And that's it. I'm doing. I don't know if we have time for questions. If we have time for questions, we can always meet each other and discuss. Otherwise, if we have time for questions, we have problems to ask again. Okay. Yes, sir.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, sir, for that good talk. Like you said, that mostly female, they have a bad habit in managing finances. It's not actually, what I want to say is that, you know, this aspect of a thing is something that is a very, very bad habit that is not helping the finance. You see, this is A, is buying aspect B for whatever amount. Before that month end, Mrs. B is also doing something. I should be. Mrs. C is doing. It's a spiral something that is never ends. And then you keep on buying a cloth of 300 euro, 250, that you are only going to wear once. And then at the end, you know, it is of no value. And to me, it is. And now there's a trend going on. You know, it's mainly women that this thing, but now they are bringing it even to men, that they want to put men also into it. And it is sad, I think. I don't know how can we, because it's ruining finances. So it's because I see it as a waste. If you have to buy a cloth of 300 euro and wear it once, and then it's of no value after that. The school fees, books, many important things in life that have to be paid are not being paid, and you have to buy this thing. And if you don't buy, you see the woman who is doing the thing, putting piling pressure, saying, buy this and that, because your own time will come and all that. And what advice do you have from that?
Thank you very much. Praise the Lord. Now, this is because our purpose is to be able to educate ourselves to be better. You know, when he asked us at the beginning, does anybody buy on impulse and put up my hand? Because I was very, very guilty of that. In those days, I would just go to the shop. I had credit card then. I would, even if I don't have the money, since I had the credit card, I don't have to think twice. I just see this thing maybe on offer and just buy. But eventually, when I learned about financial education, I learned to manage myself a lot better. Now, for the past few months now, for those who are in the running of the church, we know that we have not been very financially buoyant. And, you know, with that, if I didn't have anything to save, I would have been borrowing from everybody that is close to me. But because I've learned to manage myself when I had a bit, now that things are not as good as they used to be, I'm still able to cope in a way that I'm not an embarrassment to the church of God. Praise the name of the Lord. Now, cutting your clothes according to your cloth, not according to your size, is extremely important. Now, this is a thing, and that's why I put up my hand to talk about this, because this is something I've personally benefited from. There is nobody that can be saying they are celebrating that I will buy something from them for a shopping. When I was doing my own, they were asking, buy it. I don't do it, I won't buy it, and I won't ask people to buy it for me. It's a matter of personal policy. Where am I going in life? Because most of these clothes that we as women buy, they become rubbish at the end of the day. Now, the clothes that they will sell to me, sir, for 300 euro, if I do my work, my homework very well, I can buy it for 50 euro. I can buy it for 100 euro. Because from that money, they are going to make money to sponsor the party, and they will give me a plastic of 2 euro. So it doesn't make financial sense. We have to make our stand known to people. And if there is any crowd in my heart, is that women will learn to understand this. It is not compulsory that we, even if you want to call colors, there are whites. Everybody can have shades of white. You can say pink. People wear pink. If you feel like that will make it more beautiful, more colorful, I have no problem. But don't put people in bondage. And you are in bondage because you want to be in bondage. You can stand your ground and say, I'm sorry, I'm not buying. When I'm doing my own, they let them know, because I won't offer them in the first place. So, the lot of money that you would buy, because when you say, do the calculation, what do you think? When I think of those days, if I think of, there was a time, sir, I've been practical because I want to help you. There was a time, one of us is in business. The clothes that I bought in those days that were not fair, that I didn't really need, bags of clothes filled a car. So for the person, say, I dash you. Whatever money you make is for you. I bought it because I wasn't thinking. I bought it because the money was there. I bought it because I was impulsive. But now I know better. I love black. You will notice that I love black skirts. Black whatever. It's so easy. So whatever I have, I am not going. The shoes I have that I bought in those days, they are still there. Some of the shoes I have now, they are dated 12 years ago. And they are still good leather. Bags that I had them, they are still there with me. Why waste your money? Those money you can put aside and do something for yourself. And even if you have so much, put it in savings account. At the end of the day, you are going to make more money with your money. Don't let anybody put you under pressure. You are a child of God, resist them. Tell them, I'm sorry, I'm not buying. But if you are comfortable with it and you have the means, by all means, no church is telling you, don't buy Ashebi. But if it's going to put your finances at risk, think twice. And the Lord will help us in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Thank you so much. Sister.
Praise the Lord. It's about business, we are doing business. I just want to put it across to you. imagine now I have an offer from the bank. The bank wants to give me maybe 6.5% on the loan, and I have a running business. You understand? Like me, I don't borrow to build a house. I don't borrow to buy cars. I use my interest to do all those things. But if the bank now borrow you money, if you want to pay back, like what you said, 200 something, you should be very, very cautious that the amount you are getting from that business is going to pay back that money. And maybe after paying back the money, the profit you have is 50 euro, it's still better. Because no bank will borrow you a huge amount of money to start a business. And if a bank borrow you money, it's an opportunity. Because some other people apply, they don't give them. Because they said, God will not come down from heaven to help you. These are the financial institutions that we can tap into. And that's the advantage that we are doing business to do. So you said that 8%, but you should be very, very cautious. I have credit card that I don't use it.
Thank you very much. So my father said, so that's very good. So when you borrow, like I said, that money you are borrowing, that's a good debt. That's what I said earlier. So that not all debt are bad. So when you use debt for acquire an asset or an investment, so when for the fact that the bank gave you money first, that means you are crediting. Like I said, the bank will not give anybody money. When you go to the bank to apply for the money for good, you look at the profile and the credit history, and if you're in a good position, of course they will plumb you down. So for the fact that they will offer you that means that you have the need to manage your account properly. And like I said, you can use debt for investments, which you are doing. So it's wrong, you can use debt, borrow money and start a business. That's one of the most well